Welcome to DNB and this webcast where we'll discuss the market outlook for the SFL Corporation. I'm joined by the CEO of the company, Ole Hjertaker. It's great to have you back, Ole, and DNB's shipping analyst, Jørgen Lian. SFL have managed to navigate volatile shipping markets while maintaining profitability for more than 15 years, and at the same time paying dividends for now 62 consecutive quarters. That's pretty impressive. And this sets you apart from most other listed shipping companies. So let's start with how SFL's strategy towards shipping investments differ from other traditional shipping companies.
Yes, thank you very much, and thank you very much for inviting me back. I would say SFL is in a unique position in the markets. It's got a significant fleet. We started 15 years ago, invested in only one single segment, which was crude oil tankers. And after that, we have focused on diversification. Diversification in terms of assets, diversification in terms of counterparties, but more importantly, I would say it's diversification from a risk perspective. So we are very risk-conscious when we structure deals. We try to limit risk when we can, and we believe in risk-adjusted returns. And as we have seen over the years, it has worked. We've seen many shipping companies struggle, many shipping companies being restructured over the years, while we have been standing stable and navigating through the volatility in the market.
Yeah, you also maintain quite a bit of exposure to the spot and short-term markets through both some open vessels and also some profit-sharing agreements on the contracts that you have. Also, those contracts are both the time charter contracts and bareboat contracts, which I guess also sets you apart from typical financing houses and pure leasing houses to some degree. So what's your take on that, and how does that favor your setup?
Yes, I would highlight, you mentioned the fact that we have many vessels on time charter contracts, and that really sets us apart. This is one of the really good features of being associated with the wider Fredriksen Group. We have probably the most cost-efficient ship management setup in the market. And what that enables us to do is to deliver a high-quality product for long-term charters with very demanding counterparties, like Phillips 66, where we have vessels on time charter. We have many vessels to Maersk on time charter, Evergreen, etc. So that's one side of it. You also mentioned the fact that we have vessels in the spot market or short-term market. That is only a small proportion of the overall fleet, maybe around 10% of the total fleet. Typically, we operate vessels in the spot market if they are, call it, if they are redelivered from their long-term charters. We trade them in the market until we can recharter them at what we believe are the right market conditions. So if they are redelivered in a lower point in the cycle, we can trade them in the market. And again, with our market outreach in all these segments, we can do that. Most financial, call it financially angled institutions or companies cannot do that. They just have to take the first offer on the table. So we think that certainly sets us apart. And to the other side of it, which is the options you mentioned, we really love that. And we love to get options, not give options. So we have many charters with profit share features. We have several tanker vessels with that. We have a bunch of dry bulk vessels with profit share features. And we also have some quite interesting profit share features linked to fuel oil now, relating to the IMO 2020, upcoming IMO 2020 regulations, where we have also installed the scrubbers, where we have a profit share feature linked to actually savings. So we think this is a very important feature in terms of spicing up returns, but the basis is the long-term, the $3.7 billion backlog.
Ole, your long-term earnings visibility in such a cyclical industry would likely appeal to another kind of investor base. So how does your shareholder structure compare to that of other traditional shipping companies?
It's fundamentally very, very different. If you look at the traditional shipping investors, it's private equity or family offices, sort of ship-owning families. I would call that private equity. And hedge funds have typically invested because of the volatility. We have a very different mix. We have a very big proportion of institutional investors. Many of them are U.S.-based. And a very interesting feature, when you look at the history and you look at the statistics, we have the average hold period with these institutions is around 10 years. It's extreme stability compared to what you see in, I would say, virtually any other shipping company. But we also have a lot of retail investors. So in total, it's between 70 and 80,000 investors, predominant in the US, but also a few thousand in the Norwegian or Scandinavian market. And then, of course, we also have Mr. Fredriksen, who's got a 25% stake in the company and has been super supportive for us over the years.
Yeah.
2018 turned out to be a very active year for the company. You added $1.2 billion, approximately, dollars in backlog to close to $4 billion backlog that you have currently. You did a lot of large container vessels, and also now recently in 2019, you added another three VLCCs. And in my opinion, the container deals, the larger ones that you did with MSC, lease in, lease out structures, and also the flexibility that you showed to the Hunter VLCCs, are good examples of growth opportunity for SFL Corp going forward. So would you mind sharing how the deals came about and what advantages the SFL solution can have versus, for instance, traditional bank lending?
Oh, yeah. We source deals many different ways. We source some through our banking friends, some come through brokers, and some come through direct relationships. So starting with the MSC transaction you mentioned, to 19,000 TU container ships, you know, the biggest container ships out there, that was on the back of a long-term relationship. That was because we have a number of vessels on charter to MSC already. We meet them regularly, and then opportunities do arise. It's also an interesting example because it's a structure where we managed to package a financial lease, a Chinese finance lease, I would say. It's a financing structure for a relatively high leverage, but with no guarantees from SFL parent. So it's fully non-recourse. If something should happen there, of course, our equity is at stake, but we're not liable for anything else, which is a very interesting feature. Not many companies, and certainly not maritime companies, have that. We only guarantee around 60% of the financing in the operating subsidiaries. So that's one part. The other, as you mentioned, the most recent Hunter deal, you know, the three for the price of two deal, as we call it, was a deal that came about, I would say, very quickly. We only used around 30 hours from the first initial phone call until we have a fully committed offer, no financing subjects on the table to them. Time was of the essence. We could turn around, and because we have the capital structure we have with around $4.5 billion enterprise value, we have the capacity to take on significant exposure without going and raise financing or whatever afterwards. We can turn around and do that, but we have the flexibility to move quickly if we need to.
In terms of growth prospects going forward, traditional shipping banks have scaled back their shipping portfolios by some 24% since 2011, leaving ample opportunity for alternative financing in shipping. How is the underlying market for SFL developing, and how is the competition from traditional leasing houses and other competitors?
Yes, with the $4.5 billion enterprise value, as I mentioned, we are a relatively big fish in a small pond. So we are very high up on the radar screen for all, call it, maritime financing providers. Also, the fact that we have delivered a consistent, profitable nature over the years, never had any sort of covenant issues or whatever with the banks, gives us a very strong, call it, credit profile when we structure financings around our transactions. I would say, you know, mentioned the 22%, 24%, change, but the real effect is actually more dramatic. The European banks in this period is down probably 40%. And remember, shipping was traditionally always financed with the European banks. Well, the Chinese institution and Asian institution has grown, so the average number is smaller, but it's been much more dramatic for many shipping customers, which leaves the field open for players like us, because we can deliver everything from a fully integrated time charter product to a bareboat type product to structured financing.
So which segments do you consider the most attractive for growth near term?
Well, we look at all our core segments, and we look at deal flows between the segments. We've done a lot of, on the container side last year. We just did some tanker vessels, and we wouldn't mind grow more on the tanker space. We think there are interesting opportunities in the dry bulk market. But we always look at it on a deal-by-deal basis. We look at the risk-adjusted return in the specific deals. And also, one added, I would say, I think a positive feature with SFL is the fact that we are in multiple segments means that we can benchmark deals between the segments. What we have seen over the years, and this is just observing the markets, is that when the market is peaking, that is when the equity market is open, and that's when the banks are more keen to lend you money. Mm-hmm. I mean, that is partly why it's spiking. So, but that is exactly when you shouldn't invest. So being invested in multiple segments, you see what's happening in the various subsectors. If you see that things are really going haywire, we can pull back and we can focus our attention elsewhere, which has given us a consistent superior return compared to investors who try to invest in the single segment companies that we have seen.
Another aspect of diversification is also on the counterparty side. We count 13 counterparties today, but still two of them, MSC and Seadrill, account for around 50% of the backlog. And if we add Maersk and Evergreen and Golden Ocean, we get to close to 90. So just quickly, how do you look at that client mix currently and in your thoughts on going forward on new transactions?
Oh yeah, I think we have maybe one or two more than that, but that's not the key issue there. If you look at Seadrill, for instance, around 25%, that used to be 55% only 3 or 4 years ago. So I would say that's always a developing feature, I would say, of the company. You do transactions when you think the timing is right. We don't have any specific restrictions on volume in any specific segment or with any specific customer. But over time, we focus on diversification. Several of the names you mentioned have come in over the last 2 to 3 years only. So as we grow our business model and as we expand our customer outreach, I think it also will accelerate our ability to do deals with more clients over time and making sure that we keep a very nice risk-adjusted return for our investors.
Yes. And in terms of investment capacity, you had at the end of Q2 above $200 million in cash and another 100 plus in marketable securities. And also you've shown time and time again good access to capital markets. But we calculate at the end of the quarter a leverage of around 68%, which is considerably down from 78%, you could say, back in 2008. But going forward, how do you view the leverage of the company now in terms of your investment capacity and how that would be funded?
Our focus on leverage is project by project. And leverage is also a function of what we believe is the inherent risk in the project and also to what extent our capital is at risk, i.e. the balance sheet is at risk. As I mentioned, only 60% of the asset financings in SFL is guaranteed by parent, which means that you have a lot of flexibility there. Also, if we believe that the risk is very low, we wouldn't mind leverage some more. If we think risk is relative higher, we reduce on the risk. So we will also play on that side. So I think, you know, the fact that the banks see that and the way we structure things, you know, work has been a strength for us. And as you mentioned, the deal flow, we did $1.2 billion acquisitions last year, but the financing amount we did last year was around 1.7. So we did a lot of financing, and we think we have very, very good access to capital, not only on the banking market. We did a lot in the Chinese leasing market. We did many vessels in the Japanese leasing market. We did a convertible loan in the US. We did a bond loan in the Scandinavian market. And we are always on the outlook for efficiently priced capital, because if we can combine deal flow, superior vessel operations with better access to capital than others, we think that we have a place in the market and that we can grow with the portfolio.
Ole, you mentioned scrubbers. Maybe you could elaborate a little bit on your strategy and initiatives to meet the new IMO regulations.
Absolutely. When we charter vessels on long-term basis, it's our customers who pay for the fuel or the bunker oil. So therefore, we have agnostic approach to that for the vessels on long-term charter. We can pay for the for the scrubber installation if we get a good return on our on the investment. They can put it on the vessel if they like to. You know, that gives us a more hopefully valuable asset, and they pay for everything. Or, as I mentioned, we've also done a profit share arrangement where we install it in combination with charter extension, and that where we also get a profit share on the actual savings. What we believe is that there will be quite significant volatility in that market. Right now, for 2020, you see $240 per ton difference. And when a big container ship, for instance, burns 200 tons per day, you know, it's a lot of money. And if this market should hold, you know, it's a very short payback period for those kind of investments. Mm.
Where are you today? You have made arrangement for scrubbers on nearly 30 vessels. Is that?
Yeah, I think in the end, when we approach 2020, it will be in the mid 30s, where we pay for half of them, and our customers effectively pay and install on the other half.
Yeah. So, do you see like any opportunities or threats that may arise on the back of this?
Well, in the near term, we think there will be interesting utilization effects of that, because many of these vessels will be taken out of service for out of the ordinary dry docking schedule, and others will be longer in dry dock. We believe some shipyards will have been over eager to take in orders, so there could be some delays. So we think that could have an underlying interesting effect on the spot market in many segments. In the long run, we do believe in new technology that will help preserve, the environment, and we strongly support that. So we, of course, have an ESG strategy on that, and we know that shipping is by far the most energy efficient way to move raw materials from one place to another. So from a shipping perspective, I think we have a little way to go to explain that to the wider audience. But I think the fact that ships are recycled every so often, a ship typically only lasts, say, 20 to 25 years, means that there are not that many very old vessels out there in the market. And as we renew those new vessels and we focus on energy efficient assets, we think that will be a big plus for the market at all.
You mentioned ESG. At least we get a lot of feedback that that's increasingly important from investors. And we've highlighted one aspect of that, which could be a transition in energy from fossil fuels to renewables. A lot of shipping segments, of course, transport the fossil fuels. I guess that's some uncertainty for the traditional investors in the hard assets. Mm. Is that a good explanation why you see today the order book is at nominal low levels and year-to-date ordering as well, far behind the usual level?
I think it's a combination of two things. One thing is uncertainty on technology developments, i.e. when you order a vessel now, should you buy one with a traditional two-stroke, heavy fuel oil engine, or should you focus on LNG propulsion or a hybrid where you can do both? So that's one. But the other one that you shouldn't underestimate is the access to capital. Because leverage is not as available for everybody as it used to be, it is more expensive to order a vessel. In the old days, you could lever a vessel, 90% with yard financing, etc., and only have a very small, equity participation. Now you need to put more capital into it, and therefore it is a restriction, I would say, on growth. So I think it's positive. Typically over the years, when you see it through the cycles, it's always been the owners doing it to themselves. It's always owners who have been over excited about short-term market, and they run out and order as many vessels as they can find. And the effect of that is a very soft market. Just look at the dry bulk market the last few years. it's been a phenomenal underlying growth in demand for transportation. It's just that there have been so many new buildings coming out that it's has been choking the market. Mm. So there has been a lack of discipline, but I think the new capital environment could hopefully be an element that could discipline the market. Mm.
And one part, I guess, is the increased risk on the residual value of the vessels as well.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And how would you say that plays in terms of SFL's business?
Well, I would say when we look at the new building, we have a shorter expected life cycle for it. It's not that the vessel cannot live as long as it used to be, but you may have to make significant additional investments to make it work that long in the market. So, but we look at that all the time. I think we as a wider group, as part of the Fredriksen group, we have a lot of focus on technology development, and we think that is a strength in the market in the long run. Hmm.
Finally, Ole, we have to touch upon the share price performance, because year to date, SFL is up in excess of 35% and has been strong also compared to peers. So do you have any closing remarks to the recent optimism?
Well, yes, we've had a nice increase in share price last few months. I think it's a combination of several factors, not least that we have done a lot of new transactions that I'm sure gives investors comfort that this dividend level is sustainable and hopefully can grow over time. And also, if you look at the risk premium now with a changing interest environment, I would say the yield on the current share price is just under 10%. It's a phenomenal risk premium over, if you look at say a 5-year interest rate of around 1.5%. So if you go back historically, if you go back to before the financial crisis, say, where you had a lower yield than this, you had sort of 7 to 8% yield range, but the underlying interest rate was 4 to 5%. So I think I personally think, of course I'm biased, I think it's a phenomenal investment opportunity in assets where you have diversification in risk, counterparties and assets.
Okay, thank you so much Ole again for coming here, and thank you everybody for watching.
Thank you.